is working on the topic of smart cities and working on specifically on creating or helping to initiate 100 positive energy urban districts in Europe by 2025. We've started to work to we started our when we created the implementation plan 2 years ago for this, we thought about who would be the most important stakeholders to support this endeavor. And in doing so, we understood try to understand who puts money on the table in a city, in a town, in an urban environment. And we concluded that this would be, of course, city administrations because they invest in all the infrastructure, but there's also the utilities working for the city and around the city in energy, in waste management, in mobility, and so on and so forth. So they invest heavily as well, of course, because that's what their task is. And last but not least, the real estate sector, of course, invests in our built environment mainly. And the question is, how do those three work together, and how can we support them through research and innovation to take a path towards sustainability and towards climate neutrality or climate So the question was, is it all about business cases, or is it also about an environment where cities and maybe national authorities have to set a framework, a legal framework, to make this happen? Now we find that working that the real estate sector is the most, well, because it moves so much investment money, will have to look much more at their business cases than anyone else. And that's why we started this webinar series, where we want to find out how city administrations and real estate developers can work together for the benefit of both the public and the investors. And that's where I'd like to hand over to Robert, who can give us a bit more of a background to our webinar today. Thank you.
Thank you, Hans-Günther. My name is Robert Hinterberger. I'm a member of the program management team of the PET program of the Second Action 3.2. And now, within the next three slides, I will give you a very short introduction about this webinar series, what we're starting right now today. Okay, so what we have today for the last 1.5 hours, I will give a short introduction, like I mentioned before. Then we have a presentation of Etienne Vignali of the Lyon-Confluence project, then a Q&A session, and then discussion. So Hans-Günther already mentioned what's the aim of this webinar of today. It will be a knowledge exchange and capacity building regarding the key enablers of cooperation between city administrations and the real estate sector. So today we are starting this webinar series. Next week we will start a similar series regarding the cooperation between city administrations and utilities. Why we are starting this? Because we think this cooperation, it's the prerequisite and the key enabler of designing and implementing positive energy district, climate neutral district, or whatever kind of smart or innovative districts and urban development projects. Within this webinar series, we would like to take into account the different real estate subsectors, like, for example, the private sector, social housing, cooperatives, and so on and so forth. we would like to take into account different city strategies, different ownership structures, and of course, it's a big difference if we are talking about new development areas or if we think about existing neighborhoods and districts. Each webinar series will be about 3 to 5 webinars featuring best practice examples. Today, starting with the best practice example of Grand Lyon. And at the end, we will like to formulate a short summary about what we learned out of this best practice examples. So when we talk about the real estate sector, of course, there are a lot of subsectors like private companies, city-owned housing companies, which usually are not for profit, of course. We have cooperative, we also have grassroots initiatives. That means just people who want to create their own neighborhood. In German, it's called so-called Baugruppen. People which usually are very innovative. In some legislations, they could found cooperatives. In others, there will be different legal setups. And this will be already my last slide before handing over to Etienne from Grand Lyon. I would like just to mention the different types of interactions between city administrations and real estate developers, depending on the role of the city administration. First of all, the city administration is a kind of regulator for urban development processes. This, in any case, that means if anybody wants to develop as a city, you have classic instruments like zoning plans or even more innovative ones like urban development contracts. But also, depending on the case, the city administration could also play a role as a landowner or even a co-developer of real estate. And of course, depending on this role, the city has different possibilities and also different tasks, and there are different approaches from a city perspective how to react on this. Either you can do everything in-house, or in-house your administration, or in special cases, you can also do part of this task through a special purpose vehicle, like, for example, a company or a legal entity outside of the normal administration owned by the city. And this possibility opens new instruments, but also make it more complex sometimes. So because of this, we invited today Etienne from Grand Lyon to show us his example. In case of Grand Lyon, the city created a new company, a Société Publique Locale. It's a developer of the urban project on behalf of the city of Lyon. And this opens up a lot of possibilities and new processes how to work together with the real estate developers. And I'm very happy to hand over to Etienne for explaining us his case and how you are working together with real estate developers in Lyon.
Okay, thank you, Robert. So I presume I should share my screen now.
Yes, please.
Can you see it?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, perfect. So good morning, everyone. Indeed, I'm working for the SPL Lyon Confluence, which is the urban developer, a special purpose company created by the public authority, the city and the city of Lyon and the Greater Lyon Authority to make the urban project of particular district, which is the Lyon Confluence urban project. You can see it from the sky. I don't know if you can see my mouse.
Oh. Okay. Yes, we can.
Yeah, okay. So it's this part.
It's where the two rivers that goes across the city of Lyon are merging. So this presentation is not exactly a magic recipe for positive energy district, because the you have to keep in mind that it's a new urban project that is not finished. It's halfway through, more or less, a bit more than half of it is done. We are not sure to reach the positive energy district, but at least we are working on trying to make it a low energy district. My aim is not to provide you a kind of promotional brochure, but to share with you how do we work on this topic related to energy, what kind of difficulties or challenges we are facing, how this influences the way the progress we can make or we intend to make in the coming years, and how we try to combine the best we can, various features or various projects. For some of them, we have the possibility to have an influence, and for some other that have strong impact on us, we don't necessarily have, as urban developer, a way to tackle them easily. So I will speak about first about the context regarding geography and history also. I will speak about the governance, because there is a quite specific scheme for this urban project. And then I will give you an overview on various topics without going too much into detail, but I prefer going to detail during the session on questions. In this way, I will precise more what is of interest for you. Okay, so let's start. I'm trying to, yeah. So if we go back to the 18th century, my company didn't exist at that time, and there was not even any talk about the Lyon Confluence urban project, because actually this territory didn't exist. And even after, even more recently, this area was for a very long time a bit disconnected from the rest of the city, either physically, either in the mind of the inhabitants. So at the end of the 18th century, actually, there it was only swamps and islands. And the authorities at that time decided to reclaim the land to expand the city. So it's actually the very beginning of the Lyon Confluence urban project, almost two centuries before we start to make this urban project. On the 19th century, it was the Industrial Revolution in France and in other countries. And the first very innovative activity was implemented in the neighborhood. It was the railway. It was the first railway in France to bring the coal from another city in the western part of Lyon to the gas factory. So with the railway, the train station, the gas factory, also a jail that started to be opened in this neighborhood. And during the 20th century, various activities related to logistics in particular. Here you can see the harbor for commodities. You can see that the railways, it was not only about trains passing by, but also storage of train, with a huge area devoted to the storage of train. Here you can see the wholesale market, where market and supermarket from Lyon were coming to buy food, vegetables, flowers, and any kind of that stuff. And during the 60s and 70s, the mayor of Lyon decided that it was good to make Lyon becoming like Los Angeles, with the motorway passing right in the middle of the city. So probably that today we will do things differently, but actually this motorway contributed to create another physical barrier with the rest of the city. And today it's one of the busiest motorway in Europe because it makes the connection between the Northern Europe and Southern Europe. So it's more than 100,000 vehicles each day. So it's a strong constraint for the neighborhood, but it's there for quite a while. There you can see the gas factory. And so this means that at the end of the 90s, many activities were declining, industrial and logistics. Many activities or facilities in the neighborhood contributed to create a kind of bad image and other many issues that you don't see in the picture, but many a lot of prostitution in the neighborhood and that kind of stuff. So people were not really willing to go in this neighborhood, except if they were working there or living there for some of them, but otherwise the rest of the inhabitants really didn't to go there. Company didn't want to have their office there, so very bad image. However, it's quite a large area, and it's you can see here the historic part of Lyon, the old neighborhood, let's say, and at least the neighborhood where most of tourists come, it's there. And you can see that actually we doubled there was a possibility actually to double the size of the inner city of Lyon. And there was not that many cities in Europe with that kind of situation. So for some hand, there was a very large area in the middle of the city with a very bad image and many effort to make to renew this neighborhood. But on the other hand, there was a kind of positive side of expanding the center of Lyon and doubling its size. So in this picture, you have a kind of summary of the geography of the neighborhood. So half of the neighborhood, it's the existing neighborhood. So the existing neighborhood is more or less preserved. There, I will tell you later that it's we have many renovation projects or energy retrofitting of buildings, but more or less it remains as it was at the beginning. Not too much destruction of buildings, so it's more or less preserved. Actually, the thousand part, it's where former logistic and industrial activities took place. And it's where the new build part is realized. So either new buildings or new public spaces. And a strong challenge is to, we operate in this area, my company is operating in this area. So we have to keep coherence between the new build part and the existing parts. In order not to renew within the neighborhood the issue we had in the past between this neighborhood and the rest of the city. So trying to have coherence, trying to improve huge effort made on public spaces. Few figures, so it's 150 hectares, it's 1 million square meter to be built in the pink zone and the blue zone. Actually, the pink zone, it's the first phase, it's finished now, and we are starting the southeast part of the project. At the end, it will be around 20,000 inhabitants. Today, it's around 12,000. And it's the idea is to build a mixed-use building block, so with social housing, private housing, public facilities, shops, offices, all kind of activities, in order to have all part of the neighborhood living all the day or all the week. So the end of the urban project is planned for 2030. To make this urban project, there is a specific governance. So the city of Lyon and the Greater Lyon Authority, so the Greater Lyon gathers the city of Lyon plus 50 smaller cities around. It's really the urban area, that it's the authority for public transport, for waste management, for water management, for urbanism also. Actually, its role, it's sometimes even stronger than the city. So we work with both the city and the Greater Lyon Authority. So this, they decided at the end of the 1990s to create a private company with public authorities shareholders only. So it's only public authorities that are shareholders. We are 25 employees in this company. Just to give you a comparison, the Greater Lyon Authority, they have 9,000 employees, and the city of Lyon, I don't know, but it's certainly several thousands. So this means that there are decisions or projects that we do faster when we are 25 than we are 9,000. This decision-making process is much faster. However, the fact that public authorities are shareholders, they keep an eye on what we are doing. We have actually a contract for this UN project with our shareholders, and sometimes we make amendment to this contract with new assignments. And as the UN project is for a kind of 30 years, it's quite long, so they could have chosen to a private company, fully private company with private shareholders to make this urban project. It's a possibility. But the problem is that if you do that, you have to specify everything in detail right in the contract at the beginning. And then it's very costly and very complicated to modify the contract. So in this way, they try to take advantage of a small company, but with still a strong public or general interest, or at least public authority that keep control on it. It's actually a scheme that you can find elsewhere in France. So sometimes the urban developer or the special purpose company is a mix between private and public shareholders. Sometimes it's actually the state that create a dedicated organization. It's the case, for instance, in Paris for the new business center, La Défense, in the western part of Paris, because it's much bigger and it's actually overlap many, many different territories. But yeah, the idea is that you have a kind of mix between public and private for the urban development and the urban renewal. So as urban planner, urban developer, we have four assignments. We sell the land to real estate developer that will build the buildings. So by selling the land, we also sell the land with the guidelines and requirements they have to comply with. And we work with the real estate developer in order that they integrate properly our guidelines or requirements in their project. So it can be guidelines about the height of the building, the number of square meters they have the right to build in a particular piece of land, the architecture, the integration with the public spaces, the proportion of social housing, the proportion of private housing, proportion of offices or public facilities, for instance. And it's actually the first tool we use to improve the environmental performance of the urban project. It's in the guidelines to integrate requirements regarding environmental or energy performance that are more demanding than the French regulation, in a way to create our own rules in the neighborhood and to force them to be more ambitious. So this can also, it's not always easy to do, or at least to implement. I will tell you, we can discuss later why. However, we have to keep in mind that it's also a possibility that we can do because we not only ask, but we also try to find solution with them. Sometimes we provide also financial support thanks to European project or that kind of stuff. But it's also a thing that we can do because we are in the inner city. And probably that if we were farther in the countryside, where maybe there is less demand for building or for buying flats or that kind of stuff, it will be much more difficult to be more demanding than the French regulation. So it's a condition that we have to keep in mind. This is it for this slide. So actually the environmental performance or energy performance of the neighborhood is not the same for every project, every features. There is evolution. The guidelines or requirement we ask today is not the same as a few years ago. We try more and more to expand the topics we are working on, or at least to make progress. And we don't do that alone, of course. And we have been using many local, national, or international partnerships to make progress on all these topics related to building, rebuilding, mobility, renewable energy, and so on. So these partnerships are a way for us to get additional funding, in particular when we are testing new solutions. And once we are used to work in a different way, generally we manage to reproduce environmental performance without subsidies, but it's a good way to start at least. It's also provide us a particular framework to work with public and private stakeholders. For some of them, we are used to work with them, but for some others, they are keen to come to test new services or new construction in a limited period of time with a precise target. And more and more, we, for instance, thanks to this Concerto project with the city of Saragossa in Spain and the region of Milano in Italy, we managed at that time to make the real estate developer building with energy performance that was at that time twice more demanding than the French regulation. With this next building, so it was FP7, this one FP6, we managed to build the first positive energy block in the neighborhood. We had also partnership with a governmental agency from Japan. We have support from also some national projects. This one is about lead urban logistics. Smarter Together, we are involved with Munich, Vienna, Venice, Santiago de Compostela, and Sofia. It contributed to accelerate strongly the energy renovation in the neighborhood. And I don't go too much into detail, but it's a strong feature of our strategy or the Sustainable Action Plan is to take advantage of partnership to make progress on all these topics. Here you can have a comparison between the level of energy that is required by the French thermal regulation, so RT is for thermal regulation, and you can see that what we ask for the new construction, so it's the first phase and the second phase of the urban project, is more demanding. So we are at a point when we build positive energy building block. However, not all the new building block or positive energy. We can discuss later why. So it's a kind of what is the highest level of performance we reach. It's not exactly the average. If I try to summarize the main features regarding renewable energy in the neighborhood, you have all kind of energy or energy distribution. Some buildings are powered only through electricity, even for the heating. Some with a district heating system. Some have their own biomass. So for some of them, is gas, all kind of stuff. However, there is since 2016, the development of a district heating system powered partly with renewable energy. So it's one third of biomass. Actually, it's waste from forestry coming from the region. And it's partly from the heating coming from waste incineration. For one third, it's gas, so it's not renewable. Actually, during the first year, my company was the operator in charge of the construction of the pipes, the promotion, the information on the district heating system, and also making people paying for that. Since 2 years now, it has been connected to the rest of the city, so it's the operator in charge of the district heating system in the rest of the city that is managing it. However, it's still powered at two-thirds with renewable energy. So this is the new biomass power plant that is actually there just outside the neighborhood. There was some discussion for many years to implement a cogeneration power plant within the neighborhood, but finally this project didn't manage to become reality. So that is why it's not exactly produced locally, but it's produced in the very close to the neighborhood. So here you have a view of the construction of the pipe. So it's hot water providing either domestic house water, either heating, either both. Today there are around 20 buildings connected, either new buildings, either existing building, either building that have been recently retrofitted. But all the second phase of the project will be connected to the district heating system. Actually, in our requirements for the real estate developer, we give at least a strong incentive to connect to it. So it was not really relevant during the first phase to build such district heating system because there was not enough building built. But now it's more relevant. We have also around 30 photovoltaic installations. So it's more than 2 megawatts and 1.5 megawatts in project and going to be built in the coming years. Here you have few pictures. So this one is both pictures are a recently built building. This one is a gym hall, so it's an existing building belonging to the city, and we contributed to make this photovoltaic installation reality. This one is a refurbished building, actually, that we refurbished very recently. It's a former industrial building converted it into an incubator for IT startups. So it's another example. I said earlier that we work on improving the environmental performance of new buildings by integrating strong or demanding requirements and guidelines for the real estate developer and working with them. So here you have a few pictures. So this one actually is the first positive energy block that had been built a few years ago. It's example of how we try to integrate the wood, either in facade, either in the structure of the building. This one is a recently built building with, I don't know how you call it in English, but it's similar material that you can see in the ground to create all the walls. And we try also to integrate.
Clay, is it clay? Clay?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know the word. I should have learned it before. But
say it in French.
Terre crue.
Yeah, so it's clay. It's lean, yeah. Lean bar.
Okay, thank you. We also try to, in the guidelines, for instance, we oblige a real estate developer to build flats that have windows on both facades. For instance, north and south or east and west, in order to have a natural ventilation and to reduce the need for air conditioning, for instance. We try also to integrate a lot of green spaces within the in the heart of the building block as a way to refresh and also to improve the quality of life. There are many features. I don't go too much into detail. There are many challenges also because it's always the proper balance between what is technically feasible, what is interesting, what is local, what is new, what is expensive or not. Sometimes it's not always the balance between technical and financial. It's also because sometimes it's just new materials or new techniques, and it changed the habits, and some stakeholders are more kind than others to change their habits or to work on new stuff. Yeah, we can come back later on the new construction. Here, I would like to talk a bit about mobility. As I said earlier, we are not the, as urban developer, we are not the main authority, or we are not an authority at all in charge of mobility. That's the Greater Lyon Authority. So our main contribution is related to the guidelines for the new buildings. We forbid the real estate developer to build underground parking in the heart of the building block. So they only have the right to build underground parking under the building. This means that there is a way to have real trees and thick soil and to green a lot of, because greening it's the street, the pavement and so on, but it's also strongly, at least in the urban project, in the heart of the building block. This means that there is not enough parking spaces only under the building, because they can't really build it. They can't build a lot because there is the underground water quite close. So this means that we built a first mutual car park. So you can see a picture of the construction. It's this one is 800 places. The idea is to avoid to have a dedicated parking slot for either people who work in the neighborhood or people who live in the neighborhood. Because if you have people living in the neighborhood that work elsewhere in the city, their parking slot is empty during the day. And the other way around, people who are just working in the neighborhood but living elsewhere, they use the car park only a part of the day. And if you build public infrastructure for mobility that are not used a lot or empty part of the day, it's very costly. It's very costly for the urban project, and in a way it's costly for everyone, because we have a particular financial and legal scheme in this urban project where real estate developer, when they buy the land, on top of that, they have a financial contribution to contribute partly to the public facilities, to the public spaces. Not all of the cost, but part of the cost. Because if they can sell their flat or sell their offices, it's because they have also public facilities. So you have different kind of financial and legal scheme for urban project in France, but at least the one used there, the idea is that private stakeholder also partly have a financial contribution to the public facilities and public spaces. So in the mutual car park, this means that when you have a new building, part of the inhabitant will have a parking slot there, just right under the building, and part of it will have a right to use the mutual car park. So that's mainly what I wanted to explain about mobility, because when we talk about bus lines, tramway and so on, it's more the Greater Lyon Authority that is in charge of that and not us, even if of course we are strongly working with them when we do the road and so on. Because yeah, maybe I skip a bit this part at the beginning. I try to describe our assignment as urban developer. We have four assignments. So the one is selling the land to real estate developer. The other one is making the public spaces. So we are creating pavements, roads, places, and so on, but we are not doing the maintenance of it. Then it goes back to the city or the Greater Lyon Authority, who are in charge of cleaning the streets, repairing the lamp for the lamppost, and that kind of stuff. We are also making all the studies necessary for the urban project. And we are also in charge of public consultation when it's needed, information and communication on the project. So that's only our four assignments. So we are not the owner of the buildings. It's very important to keep in mind, because this means that we can't necessarily do whatever we want with the building, and we always have to work with either real estate developer, either the owner of all buildings. Regarding energy retrofitting, so if I try go back a bit, energy retrofitting, it's either in this part, either in this one, because there are many parts of the wholesale market that are preserved as heritage, as a memory of the territory. So this means we try actually to work on energy retrofitting for many years, but it's complex and difficult, and we managed to get tangible results only during the last years. So today, if we look at the energy retrofitting projects that are either finished, either in progress, either confirmed, we have almost 20 projects, 70,000 square meters. It's all kind of size. I think the smallest buildings retrofitted, it's 1,500 square meters. And the biggest one is a social housing block. It's 25,000 square meters. So we try to work with all kinds of buildings, either the ones owned by private group of owners, like this one. So in the area, the building of this kind is, it's not big buildings. It's between 15 to 35 flats and 15 to 35 individual owners. We work with social housing operator. We have two big social housing blocks. So one from 150 housing and the other ones from 250 housings. And we are also targeting either office spaces, other public facilities to make energy retrofitting. So there are different kinds of intervention for the private group of owners and the social housing operator. We are supporting them, either technical support, either financial support, to make their project reality. Sometimes we work with real estate developer for office spaces, for instance, when we sell the land with an already existing old buildings. In the guidelines, we put some requirements regarding energy performance to oblige them to make energy retrofitting and with a good energy performance. But sometimes it's the case for several public facilities. The city of Lyon or the Greater Lyon ask us to make and conduct directly ourselves the energy retrofitting and to conduct the studies and the works. So it's interesting to point it out, the fact that initially it was not an assignment in our contract to make energy retrofitting. We decided to work on this topic in order not to keep coherence between the oldest part of the neighborhood and the new build part. We were thinking, okay, that's nice to try to improve the energy performance of the new building, but if the oldest part of the building we are not addressing energy retrofitting, it's not coherent and it's not really interesting. And little by little, we manage to sometimes to get a European project that supported funding, sometimes to get an additional assignment from the city from the Greater Lyon to support a few projects, sometimes to get an additional assignment to conduct directly as contracting authority the energy retrofitting. So little by little, we make progress on a topic that was not, we were not created for that initially, contrary to other organizations in France who are really created from the start to make energy retrofitting. So that's another feature. regarding data management, or how we can try to use data management to improve energy performance. This picture, actually, it's more an objective than a current status. We in several projects of the neighborhood, so either electric mobility services, some photovoltaic installation, the district heating systems, some buildings that are new and that are refurbished, or even the electric grid, we try little by little to collect some data. So it's not individual data, it's more aggregated data, but with a time step that and a level of detail that allow not only to see how much we consume or we produce, what is the energy production, but also to compare and to explain why we have possible discrepancy between the theoretical performance and the actual performance. It's a process that is quite long and complicated to put in place, actually, even with the clear guidelines, even with open standard of data, even with strong support from our side to implement properly the meters and the sensors. We can come back more in detail in the question, but it's much more complicated than what we can heard sometimes in the media or the conference, that smart city, it's very easy to collect data and it's not complicated and blah, blah, blah. There are many stuff that make it complicated, even for simple stuff. However, for us, it's we think that it's a good way to get feedback on what we are doing and how we can make progress on this topic. So we work closely with the data platform of the Greater Lyon, not to make this data open, because people living in the building are not necessarily keen to have their energy consumption open to everybody, but at least to use their infrastructure as a way to compare few of the projects of the neighborhoods for the moment, even if we have the objective of having all the neighborhood, but it's a quite long process. So yeah, it's another feature. I talked a lot about energy because, of course, that's the topic, but I would like also to give you other example of what we are working on in sustainable development. I showed you a picture at the beginning of my presentation with the motorway. So the motorway is there, actually. In the new building, for instance, this one under construction, we have been working with the real estate developer to make it reversible, meaning that at the beginning, as there is the motorway, it will be office spaces. But we can imagine that maybe in 10 years or the motorway would be strongly reduced, and in this way it will be much more interesting to have housing because the river is just there. So the construction and the design is made in order that to make it easier to convert it from office spaces to housing. So that's another topic we're working on. This building actually, it's the one you see there. It's, I don't know what is the appropriate English word, but a healthcare house or health house. We work with many healthcare professionals, also professional organization in the field, in the health industry, also insurance, in order to create a specific business model for a place that will provide and gathers many professional of the healthcare industry, so some specialists or doctors or so on, in order to provide a broad range of services for the inhabitants, in order also to have a better connection within the neighborhood to take preventive action For instance, we are trying to develop measures on the air quality. We are working closely with social housing operators in order that sometimes, some period during the years when we know there is pollution, we can inform them in advance, or maybe taking or putting stronger connection between the health professional and older people living in social housing block, for instance. Because actually in France, there is a public and private systems in thanks to which you can be paid back from your healthcare expenditure when you are sick. But if you take action to avoid to be sick, nobody is taking care of that. You've got hospital, you've got doctor, but you don't have a very strong development of activities or facilities that favor preventive action to keep good health. So it's not going to be the revolution, but it's a facility that, because we don't have hospital in the neighborhood, there are hospital elsewhere in the city. It's the first building of this kind built in the city. And it's from what we heard with the professional we're working on, it's maybe a good way to complement the existing offer and to, yeah. So just to show you that, like we did for the energy, we didn't start the urban project with energy retrofitting. We didn't start the urban project with data management, and we make progress little by little on energy. But it's also a bit the same process for other topics. Healthcare, it's not a topic normally for us, but as we are trying to enrich the features of the urban project, we also more and more learning to work with other stakeholder or new stakeholder for us. And then it is also a way to combine what kind of work or the kind of relation or collaboration we already have with real estate developers, to work with them on new topics, on new field that can be also of interest for them in other urban projects. So it's a never-ending learning process, let's say. This is my last slide before we go to the questions. We are more and more aware of what needs to be improved and so on. And we try to be part of a collaborative framework at local level, at national level, and also at European level. So at the European level, we have recently won with the European Commission the SCALE project, which is the coordination of all the consortium involved in the Smart City project. So it's a way to continue the effort and the collaboration at the European level on the topic related to energy performance, renewable energy, data management, mobility, and so on. At the national scale, we are a part of a club that gathers the most of the urban developers in France. And we are currently leading a working group on digital in urban planning and development, how digital can help or can change some of the business model or some of the assignment or missions of the urban developer, and what can be the relevant balance between private and public sector. So we don't have the conclusion yet. It's in progress, but even if what we have done so far in the in digital can be much more difficult than we expected, what we expected, can be sometimes seen as not enough, or it's a first step for us, and the next step is also to continue to work on this topic, even at a national level with the urban developer that are maybe for some of them not used at all, and some of them much more advanced than we are. So it's another another framework. And at the local level, thanks to our last European project, Smarter Together, we managed to have concrete results on energy renovation, even if it's still a small part of the existing neighborhood. And we try to provide feedbacks, not only for the European Commission and not only for the city, but also to share our finding and our return on experience with all the ecosystems of stakeholders. So construction company, company operating in facility management, architect, engineers, organization active in training, social housing operator, many stakeholders. So we created a club of stakeholders, mainly active in the Greater Lyon area, and we are now quite satisfied on the contribution of all the stakeholders who are very interested and sometimes who work also not necessarily in our neighborhood, but who have also very interesting projects. And actually, last year there was the municipal election, so the new elected representative with new strategy or new thinking for the coming years. And we are now trying to mobilize all these 50 partners to make proposition for the city, for the Greater Lyon, to their strategy related to energy retrofitting. How can support can be maybe adapted a bit? And so it's also interesting for us to share our experience with the cities and the Greater Lyon and all the stakeholders in order to contribute to interesting project also outside our district, but still in the same city. So this is a view of the Lyon Confluence at the end of the urban project in 2030. I'm done regarding the main overview, at least the first overview. So please feel free to ask questions or ask me if you want more detail on some of the topics.
Thanks, Etienne, for this great, interesting, and very insightful presentations.